nosegay and the stout, a bouquet of belly laughs and a corsage of cuties, starring the fairest flower of all, Miss Sherry Britton.
I'm sure that you've all seen burlesque, so it's not new to you. You won't be shocked by what we wear or what we say and do. So fun is our main goal tonight. Here's bottoms up to you. Just like those good old days. Remember those old burlesque days, the way the girls would shake the comics and the straight men when they did a double take. The strippers who could prove that not an inch of them was fake. Those were the good old days. Golden memories of the runaway. Golden memories of the runway. Golden memories of the runway. We've got that same old pitchman selling postcards from Paris. And I can promise you we'll still see just as much of me as in those good old days. Golden memories of the runaway. Golden memories. Oh, bring on that blue spotlight. Burlesque. Let me spell it out for you.
B.
Body.
U.
Undressed.
R.
Racing.
L.
Laughs.
E.
Exciting.
F.
Sexy.
U.
Quips.
U.
Undressed.
Miss Britton, you've already said that.
Well, let's face it, there was a lot of undressing. Entertainment. Now, that was burlesque. It may not spell mother, but it certainly pleased father. Back in the days when movies were in their infancy and TV was only a gleam in the CBS eye, it was an off-limits classroom for high school and college boys. How many of you fellows out there tonight took that course? It was a hideout for salesmen and a springboard for such talents as Al Jolson, W.C. Fields, Eddie Cantor, Fanny Bryce, and even, so help me, Sarah Bernhardt. And later on, for some people that I worked with, Phil Silvers, Jackie Gleason, Red Buttons. Once burlesque was a rooster strutting and crowing in 1,000 theaters across the country, 17 of them in New York City alone. Then it became practically a dodo bird, all but extinct. Tonight, for a little while at least, let's make it a rooster again. And what better way to begin than by bringing on the chickens?
Gonna rather than drummer.
No time, ain't no time to.
I got a letter from my boyfriend. He's staying true.
True to his wife.
Shine on, harness. You'll be my guy.
January, February, June, and July.
By the lights of the Silvery.
If you were nominated as the hippie candidate, what would your slogan be?
Only one, man. Some pot in every chicken.
I want to spin.
Here we are out of town, and I just got this telegram from my wife. Not getting any better. Come home quick.
Gee, that's too bad. Let me see it. Well, you can't even read. This says not getting any. Better come home quick.
Keep a shining engine. Your silver beam will bring home dreams. We'll be traveling soon.
We'll be traveling soon.
My silver beam.
My silver beam.
Long ago, but one of those girls used to be me. That's how I began, in the chorus line of the People's Theater on the Bowery in New York. Sherry Britton, age 13, also 38, 18, 33. Well, I was big for my age, everywhere. Now, you may think 13 too young for a girl to be showing her all, or nearly all of her all. But remember, those were depression days, and for me it was either make like Eve or sell the apples. Fortunately, the theater owner thought I was more of a pip than a pippin. So there I was in show business, watching and acting in scenes that convulsed burlesque audiences. You know the definition of a burlesque audience. That's where a fellow taps the lady in front of him and says, "Lady, would you mind removing your hat and blouse and skirt?" Yes, there I was in the wonderfully wacky world of show business and burlesque, watching scenes like Ask Me No Questions.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am the man on the street, and I'm out to get the opinions on some of the important issues of the day. Pardon me, miss.
Yes?
I'm the man on the street. I was wondering if you'd answer a few questions for me.
Why, of course.
Thank you very much. Which do you think is healthier for a newborn baby, bottle feeding or breastfeeding?
Why, bottle feeding, and for three good reasons. One, it's pasteurized. Two, it's homogenized. And three, it's civilized.
Thank you very much.
See the way she looked at me?
Not really.
Me either. Who are you?
Oh, I'm the man on the street.
Oh, you poor fellow. What happened? You couldn't pay your rent?
No, you don't understand.
I knew a couple of ladies on the street. They never had any trouble paying their rent.
No.
You used your rent money on the ladies?
No. You don't understand. You see, I'm the man on the street, and I'm out to get the opinions on some of the important issues of the day.
Important issues of the day?
That's right.
Well, let's see now. One of the most important tissues is Kleenex. There's pocket tissue and facial tissue, but the most important tissue of all is toilet tissue. Now remember now, in the roller derby, the good guys finish last.
I'll keep that in mind. Could I have a little background information
sure.
on that, sir? Thank
yep.
you. When were you born?
Oh, and I was just a little kid.
No, I mean, what year?
1925.
Okay, which month?
July.
Oh, under what sign?
One says hospital, 5 miles. The old man was driving like crazy. All of a sudden, he had a flat tire. 5 minutes later, my mom was flat, too.
My first diaper was a road map.
Is that right?
Yep. 6 months later, you could still see Pittsburgh right over here.
Can we go on?
Sure.
It was Harrisburg over here. In Philadelphia was right.
Excuse me, sir.
Nobody ever wants me to point out Philadelphia.
Experience, military?
None.
Banking?
None.
Writing?
None.
Sexual?
None. Actually, I've had some. Not as much as I'd like, though. I'm available, too. My number is 924-3677. In New Jersey, the number is...
Excuse me, sir. Are you a married man?
Oh, I'm married. Yep, you better bet you I'm Red Ryder.
Yeah? Tell me, how's the missus?
Oh, she's fine, thank you.
Thank you.
Very nice of you to ask. Sometimes she has a little pain right there, you know.
Oh, she probably has acute angina.
Cutest little thing you ever saw.
Where did you first meet your wife, sir?
What's that?
I say, where did you first meet your wife?
In the supermarket. I was reaching for the tuna fish. I grabbed the wrong can. She's a good sport about it, though, so we started talking, you know, dancing around those aisles there, you know. Later on, we decided to get married. We happened to be of different religions, so she changed over to mine. At our wedding, they threw converted rice. She'd have thrown puffed rice, because by that time, she was, where the hell is it?
Tell me, as one married man to another, are you getting any on the side?
I didn't know they moved it. He didn't know either, did he? Go on.
You like television?
Do I like television?
Yeah.
I love television. I'm a big TV fan.
Oh, yeah? You like the commercials?
Love commercials.
Is that right?
I love a commercial so much, I go to the bathroom during the regular program.
Let me ask you a question. What do you think of the Jolly Green Giant?
Jolly Green Giant?
Yeah.
He's big, isn't he? Yeah. I hear to tell he's got one hell of a zucchini on him. I'd like to see that old Green Giant just one time walk into the supermarket, you know, and find old Mr. Whipple and just squeeze the hell out of him. And then find Madge, you know, Madge, you know, that old Green Giant come up and say, hey, Madge, how's about me soaking in it? He's big.
Let me ask you another, he's big.
Yeah.
Let me ask you another question.
Yeah.
Are you for or against topless waitresses?
Well, I'm against them.
Really? Why?
Yeah, well, it was bad enough when the waiters used to get their thumbs in your suit. They're dangerous. Those topless waitresses are dangerous. One of them walked up to me and says, what do you have? And I said, well, I might have a couple of those. She says, fresh. I said, if they're fresh, I'll take them. Busted me right in the eye.
Busted you right in the eye?
I said that myself.
Oh, you did. And now for my final question.
Yeah?
Which do you think is healthier for a newborn baby, bottle feeding or breastfeeding?
Oh, breastfeeding, for three very important reasons. One, the containers are so cute. And they're always there, you know, you never have to go out to the corner and get more. And two, the kid can always have a friend over for lunch. And three, and the most important of all, they're up so high the cats can't get to them.
While every comic wants you to become a top banana, the goal of a chorus girl was to have a solo spot. Just let one of the strippers sneeze twice in a row, and each girl was ready to jump into her shoes and out of her clothes. And in case the great day ever came, each girl usually had a dance prepared built on a gimmick such as a uniform. One girl I remember came out in a sailor suit and stripped down to three strategically placed signal flags. And believe me, everyone got the message. Others went along with the news and events of the day. So in 1927, when Charles Lindbergh flew the Atlantic, you know somewhere, there was a stripper calling herself Lynn Berg and just dying to take off everything.
The blue, our hopes are flying with you. Up there alone, you're fate unknown. Your country waits and watches, but you'll come through. Show the heart of the skies. You are your Uncle Sammy's finest prize.
How'd you like to go off with that into the wild blue yonder? Though more Dr. Cronkite than Dr. Spock, Burlesque was still a beehive of babies. It was, baby, how about having a drink with me after the show tonight? Or, baby, you ought to be in movies. And I've got a camera up in my room. And when it came to sketches, the hallowed institution of impending motherhood was loaded with laughs. Or should I say pregnant with them? Anyway, it's just about visiting hours at the lying-in section of the local hospital. So join us as we present From Here to Maternity. Or, honestly, Harry, somebody must have switched my pills that night.
Now, nurse, I left our patients watching TV, and I think today's the day we add to the population explosion.
Well, how can you tell, Doctor?
When I left, they were watching Make Room for Daddy. Now, over here is Mrs. Vanderpool, and over here is Mrs. Liverpool. I'll be down at the laboratory working on my latest experiment.
Well, what's that?
A birth control pill combined with a deodorant. It really takes the worry out of being close. Ta-ta.
Hello? You say Mr. Vanderpool is downstairs. And Mr. Liverpool? Well, send them both up.
Nurse, has my wife had the doctor yet?
No!
Oh, no, I mean, has the doctor had my wife yet?
No,
I mean, has the doctor had the baby yet?
No! You mean, has your wife had the baby yet?
Yes, that's what I mean. This is our first child, and I'm so nervous.
Oh, don't be nervous. Just sit down. It could be any minute now.
Thank you.
Did the little punk arrive yet?
What?
The little bastard, did he arrive yet?
Well, that's a terrible thing to call that baby. Why, that would mean that you and the mother aren't married.
Did the little bastard arrive yet?
No, not yet.
Well, he's sure taking his time about it. I'm outside double parked.
Well, what are you complaining about? Your wife is doing all the work.
Yeah, but I give her the idea. Nearly broke my back working the idea out.
Please, take a seat. I'm sure everything will be just fine.
She's sure taking her time about it. What's she doing back there anyway?
She's watching TV.
Watching TV? Hope it's not Mission Impossible. I gotta get back to the office. My secretary's sitting on her own lap.
If I'm going outside now, if there's anything you need, just call.
Oh, nurse!
Yes, is there something you need?
Yeah, could you wind that up again and throw it over here? When the old lady gets out of here, I think I'll check in.
The joy of becoming a father is overwhelming. To think that child will be the result of two souls in perfect harmony.
Never heard of doing it with two souls before. Damn it, if that ball game hadn't been rained out that night, this never would have happened.
I know my child is going to look just like her mother. Beautiful enough to be in the movies.
Bet that kid of mine looked just like the old lady. Perfect for the movies. Planet of the Apes.
Oh, hello there.
Hello yourself.
Are you a prospective father?
Just waiting for the kid to be born.
Well, then you're gonna have a baby too.
Well, I look like a female impersonator. My wife's gonna have the baby. I'm the father. I think it's a 50-50 chance I'm a traveling salesman.
Oh, what do you sell?
Mini skirts.
How's business?
Looking up. What line are you in?
No, I'm the president of a firm that manufactures models of old-time sailing ships.
Models of old-time sailing ships?
That's right.
Hey, that's very interesting. What's your biggest seller?
Frigate.
Don't have to get nasty about it. Just ask you what your biggest seller was.
Frigate.
Well, screw you, too!
Nurse!
She probably just wants a reception on a TV fix.
Yeah.
Well, they cleared up her channel. What kind of hospital is this? Kids are born with their clothes on.
Nurse, can I please see my wife now?
Certainly.
Thank you.
They took the baby, but they left the playpen.
Hello, darling. How do you feel?
Marvelous. I'm ready to go home now. It's been the greatest thrill of my life. I want to have another next year.
Call me if there's anything I can do to help. There's old Seth Cole.
You mean Mrs. Liverpool?
No, she uses her maiden name.
What do you want, boy or girl?
I'd like to have a little girl. You see, my mother's name is Rose. I'd like to name the kid after her. I'd like to name the kid after her.
Congratulations!
Hey, here it is now. A little boy? Just my luck. I wanted Rose to get one with a steel. Kid looks like it was conceived during a power failure. Mine. I'm going to call this one Schaefer because I think I'm having more than one.
A little boy!
Hey, you give trading stamps here? My God, she's watching Bonanza! I gotta go to the zoo.
What?
I'm scheduled to give the rabbits a pep talk. Close the doors, they're coming through the windows.
Quadruplets!
Quadruplets, boy, I hit the jackpot. Quadruplets, there'll be commercials, endorsements, millions of dollars. Oh, Ness, you give me the wrong baby here. It's not my baby.
No, that's your baby.
Well, guess who's coming to dinner?
While Burlesque was quick to latch on to the news and the events of the day, it was equally at home turning back the pages of Americana. If the Indians thought they had it rough with the U.S. cavalry, they were really slaughtered by Burlesque choreographers. It was enough to make the Sioux sue and the Blackfoot eat crow. When chorus girls turned squaw and the hero whooped it up in Make It Pronto Tonto.
When I'm calling you, will you answer too? That means I offer my love to you to be your own. If you refuse me, I will be blue and waiting all alone. But if when you hear, my love call, ah, ringing clear,
oh,
and I hear your answering echo so clear, then I will know at last you come through. You'll belong to me, I'll belong to you.
What is this? Gotta talk
to me.
Ow!
Not so tight! I break you, Manitou, like any boy. Manitou, love for so will love me because of you. Yes, they do. Manitou.
Hey, you girls ever play Cleveland? Hal? I know, Hal. When?
Hold it. What are you, some kind of Indian nut? Out of there. What the hell? We'll sacrifice him.
Yes,
tell me, Hannah.
Oh, great Manitou, this soldier is our gift to you. How do you like your sacrifice?
Medium rare.
This gift is to avenge the white men, having taken my betrothed when we were both 2 years old. I still remember we were crawling around on the teepee floor when his breechcloth slipped. He had Pittsburgh on his left cheek.
I got Pittsburgh on my left cheek.
And Harrisburg on his right cheek.
I got Harrisburg on my right cheek. And I got Philadelphia on my left cheek. Nobody ever lets me point out Philadelphia.
Pocus, no more Pocahontas. Now, no recollection of the runway days would be complete without mentioning that vanishing race, the stage door Johnny. Did you know the girls had them in categories? There were drugstore Johnnies, those who could be counted upon to buy a girl the cosmetics she needed. There were dinner Johnnies, there were nightclub Johnnies, and believe it or not, there were G-string Johnnies. Thank you. This is a G-string. Only it doesn't go on a violin or a cello. It goes... Well, anyway, you can see it's elaborately beaded, all handmade, and cost a small fortune. Thank you. For some girls, of course, it was a game of how much can I get from him before he gets too much from me. She was the vamp who's been around since time began and was always a favorite subject in burlesque, as you will see, when we slink into Watch Your Wallet, Boys, or a loaf of bread, a slug of wine, and pow!
Thank you.
got in your pockets that made this lady faint?
Pockets? Who's got pockets?
There were two times in history when Chicago was set on fire. The first, when Mrs. O'Leary's cow kicked over the lantern. And the second, when Little Egypt did her belly dance at the Old World's Fair. Now, I don't know when belly dancing began, but I'll bet soon after the world started rotating, so did the first beautiful tummy. Every girl has a torso, but when she has a torso that's even more so, it becomes a particular elation for the male population as we present our sensation of rotation, Michelle.
An artist with her belly. When she quivers, even jelly's jealous.
Thank you.
choreographers were always frantic for new production ideas. Besides having to contend with limited budgets, they also had to contend with limited chorus girls. Somewhere in this world, there must have been an overabundance of right feet, because in burlesque, it seems every chorine had two left ones. So in desperation, choreographers turned to props, especially those that were cheap and colorful and could cover a multitude of sins, but a minimum of skins. So for your approval, and in the hopes that all slingshots have been checked, we present Move Over, Pavlova. Burlesque comedians discovered that there were howls in the halls of justice. So, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, may we present our next case, which had to be the original miscarriage of justice. Someday, my prince will come.
Don't anybody move, don't anybody budge. Here's the line you've been waiting for. Here comes the judge.
Oh, I feel so good.
Court, let's hear the first case on the docket. I mean, like, docket to me, baby.
Who are you?
I am the attorney for Mr. Lee.
Don't I know you?
Well, I am a very prominent attorney. I've been before the bar quite often.
Sure, and that's it, O'Reilly's. Don't you remember me? I'm the bartender there on the weekends.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, scotch and coke, right?
Make it a double.
So you're Mr. Lee.
I don't remember.
These questions are going to get harder as we go along.
This is Mr. Lee, Your Honor.
I don't remember.
Your Honor, my client has had amnesia.
Your client has had amnesia?
Yeah.
Big deal. Everybody's had her.
I don't remember.
Try to remember when you're not supposed to remember, okay?
Good morning, Your Honor.
Good morning there, little honey. Whose are you?
I'm the attorney for Mrs. Lee. I am a professional lady.
Don't worry about that, honey. She's on trial today.
Oh, Your Honor.
Honey, I can be bribed.
Your Honor.
All right, do it the hard way. Now, what we have here is a divorce case between Mr. and Mrs. Franklin Ulysses Roy Lee. Franklin Ulysses Roy Lee, that's a hell of a long name there. Referred to hereafter as the F.U. Roy Lee divorce case. Mrs. Lee is suing on grounds of adultery, right?
Unfortunately.
What do you mean, unfortunately? That's the best kind. I swapped my vacation with two other judges to get this case. I hope you have pictures to back up your charges. They promised me you'd have pictures.
We have plenty of pictures, Your Honor. of that man in bed with another woman cohabitating.
Does that mean what I think it means?
What do you think it means?
Oh, come on, ask you first.
Not only do we have pictures, but we have the name of the cheap, sleazy motel frequented by the type of woman in those pictures.
The name?
The No-Tell Motel.
The No-Tell Motel. I know it well. I've had motel and that motel, and you can
see... You don't stay at this time. Then my client is countersuing for divorce.
On what grounds?
Also on the grounds of adultery.
You mean your client is accusing that sweet young innocent of doing naughty things?
Absolutely. I
can hardly believe that. Let's make that a definite maybe. I hope you also have pictures. There's no fun without pictures.
We have pictures, Your Honor.
I can hardly believe it. Case I've been waiting for 35 years. A doubleheader! This could be the pinnacle of my judgeship. Go on, Counselor.
The first thing I would like to say, Your Horseship, is that on the night of February 31st, a cold and bristly night, much like this woman's personality, I might add. You see, my client had had to hire a private detective.
What'd you call me?
Your Worship.
Didn't sound like Your Worship. You sure you're not suffering from some disease?
Which one?
Hoof and mouth.
Nay, nay.
Nay, nay. Continuing. Tell me all about the pictures.
Yes, Your Honor, we intend to produce pictures that will show that woman in bed with another man wearing nothing but a bra and panties.
He's wearing nothing but a bra and panties? This is getting better all the time. Three cup case of Corpus Nelly. Well, if not a case, a half a case. A six pack, half a pint, go on.
So, there they were in bed together on this night of February 31st, Your Horseship. That cold night that I had talked about previously, where my client's private detective had appeared on the scene, you see, Your Horseship. You see, my client had had to hire a private detective. You see, the detectives actually showed up with a, in a 59 Cadillac.
What'd you call me this time?
Your Worship.
Look, from now on, you just call me Judge. I've had enough of Your Horseship.
Very well. And then, Sludge.
Sludge! Ah, hell, go on, just call me Your Horseship.
Your Horseship.
Shut up! Now I talk. Your line is I don't remember. Nobody ad-libs around here except me, because... because I am justice!
Justice what?
Just as smart as you are. Get the hell out of the way. Come on, honey, take it, take.
Your Honor, my client is a decent woman from an outstanding background.
A pretty outstanding foreground there, too.
Her mother was a pillar of society, and her father held a very high post.
See, no wonder the poor thing's got problems. Tossed from pillar to post.
When my client first met her future husband, she was a shy, innocent, virtuous girl, a junior in college.
You're contradicting yourself, Counseloress. Your client can either be a shy, innocent, virtuous girl or a junior at college. Can't be both. You must remember what Dorothy Parker said. If all the girls at a Yale weekend were laid end to end, I wouldn't be surprised. And you have to remember that those fraternity parties are nothing but wild drinking sex orgies, and they've got to be stopped.
But why, Your Honor?
Because I'm not getting any.
Your Honor, at this time, I would like my client to take the stand and tell you in her own words the humiliation she has suffered.
But of course. Come right this way, little darling. Hold him. Climb right up here and address the court. And bring us to tears with...
excuse me.
Your Honor, what are you doing?
I'm trying to get to the bottom of this. Is it morning already? All right, here we go. Now, one, two, three, four, five. I got rhythm. There go the judge. You go on, little darling, and address the court.
Judgy Pam, when my husband was courting me, he was the sweetest thing. He brought me candy, flowers, jewelry, took me to the nicest places, and was the most affectionate and gentle of men. But on my wedding night, I realized I married a monster.
That big, huh?
That first night, without the least consideration for her inexperience, he ripped off all her clothes, threw that poor shrinking Violet across the bed, and deflowered her.
I don't remember.
After he had taken his pleasure with me, Judge Honey, he went out and had affairs with two other women that same night. Can you imagine such gall?
Can you imagine such strength? Wish I had as much to forget as he don't remember.
Well, it's been that way ever since. In 10 years of marriage, I have never had a husband who was faithful.
Well, the way he keeps going off, he sounds more like Old Faithful.
Well, finally, she could take no more. And so she hired a private detective and a photographer to catch him in one of his flagrant affairs. And I have the pictures here to prove it. I offer them in evidence.
Hot damn! Just a little something to catch the drool. Thank you, baby. Some kind of a sadist? Give me the pictures here.
Your Honor, I refuse to let you see these pictures until my client's story is told.
Chancellor, you've got a much better chance of winning this case if you let me see those pictures right now.
No.
Half of them.
No.
Peek at a couple.
No.
Well, let me hold them. I won't look.
Absolutely not. Until my client's story is told, these ugly snapshots will remain safely tucked away in my top pocket.
Hot cinders! Get on!
First thing I'd like to do, Your Honor, I'd like to give you a little background information on my client. Starting from the humblest of beginnings, my client worked his way upward, ever upward to better himself. While working 20 hours a day at any kind of menial labor, he continued to advance himself job by job, position by position, until finally he achieved success. Your Honor, my client is a self-made man. Don't you think that's admirable? Don't you think that is commendable? Your Honor!
I'm trying to score a couple of points myself. I get on with it if I must listen, I must continue.
Since he was working so hard most of the time, he never had a chance to learn about women, which made him fair game for any shrewd, scheming, conniving woman. How was he to know when he met that woman that she would snare him as easily as a spider traps a helpless fly? And after she married him, she was out looking for other men to feed her insatiable appetite for pleasure.
Are you getting hungry?
But she had no qualms about who she picked. Anyone. The milkman. The grocer, the butcher, the baker. Ow!
I always wanted to be a candlestick maker.
And all the while, my client was working night and day to keep her in her luxuries. But after a while, Your Honor, my client caught on to what was happening, and he hired a private detective to keep tabs on her.
But this woman and the detective went into her apartment, but this woman was so brazen she lured the detective into the apartment where she tried to seduce him. And the detective tried to get away, Your Honor, but she chased him. She chased him from the kitchen into the bedroom, and from the bedroom into the living room, and from the living room into the bathroom. And there in the bathroom, Your Honor, she grabbed him by the drain pipe. And then she grabbed him and took him right back into the living room. And there in the living room, on the couch, Your Honor.
She grabbed him by the drain pipe? Are you sure?
Sure. Positive, Your Honor. As a matter of fact, it is the pictures of that event that we intend to produce in evidence here today.
Hot dogs! Now we're getting down to it. Pass the pictures up here. Rule on this case right now. Hey, fellas and girls, hey, the pictures. Come on now.
Your Honor, something wonderful has happened.
Good.
Our clients have decided to reconcile, and therefore there was no need to continue with this case.
The hell there isn't. I haven't seen the pictures yet. I've been waiting 35 years for a case like this. I didn't get to see a thing. Your mother.
Well, if that's the way you feel, goodbye. There are plenty of men who want to take me home.
Your Honor, where are you going?
Are you kidding? From now on, I'm taking my own pictures.
Was a purely American art form, and its forte was comedy, whether raunchy or slapstick. But eventually the stripper took over from the comic, and the more exciting her gimmick, the greater in demand she was, as witness our Beverly.
Thank you.
To continue, newspapers and history weren't the only sources from which burlesque borrowed. It also took the choicest meat from every form of entertainment and ground it down to hamburger. If movies gave you South Sea epics, burlesque gave you a South Sea epic that was enough to make Dorothy L'Amour flip her sarong. Tonight, the natives are very restless as we bring you Umgawa.
Yeah.
you been trying?
Why, ever since I first got into town yesterday.
That long, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Honey, I've been standing outside this casting office so long the city's condemned me 3 times. Just doesn't happen that fast.
Well, I know I got what it takes.
If you have any trouble getting rid of it, you can look me up.
Hiya, Cletus.
How you doing yourself?
You want to be in the movies?
Yeah.
Oh, I do act.
You know how to act?
Watch this.
If that's acting, I'm Tricky Dicky.
That's terrific. You're hired.
Well, she's going to do to that movie fellow what I did to 200 million people. I mean, I can act that good. Watch this. Here's my big chance now. I'm going to do my famous soliloquy for yon casting person. I sat beneath a chestnut tree. A flock of birds flew over me. Alas, there is no place to sit. I didn't know that birds could spit. I just can't break into the movies. I've been trying so long. Only had one role so far, and that was an Italian role. I only had one role so far. That's the way it's been going. And now for my famous rope trick. I'm gonna hang myself because I'm sick of show business. There ain't many place to hang it. I wouldn't do it this way, except I know that the cleaning lady comes tomorrow. Oh, God, jeez, you scared the hell out of me then. I almost pulled the trigger.
Were you gonna kill yourself?
No, it's a new way to get wax out of your ears. What'd you stop me for? By now, I could have been on that big movie lot in the sky.
Believe me, shooting yourself is not the answer.
Well, I tried the rope, but I couldn't find any place to hang it. Hey! Be a nice fella. Hold the end of it real tight. Now, I'll run myself to death. I don't think this is gonna work. I'm too out of shape. I'll die before I can kill myself this way.
What do you want to kill yourself for anyway?
I can't get a job in the movies. Why, that's ridiculous.
A strong, handsome, virile, good-looking, sexy man like you.
Is your name Bruce?
No, my name is Cecil B. DeMille Due.
And you know something? I'm directing a film right now starring Art Hudson. How'd you like to be Art's stand-in?
Oh, come on, get out of town. Me stand-in for Art Hudson? Get away!
Yeah.
Wait a minute. Why does Art Hudson need a stand-in?
Well, because there's a lot of sexy, juicy, passionate love scenes in the film, and Art has a jealous wife. What do you say?
I say anything for Art. Let's go.
Now, today we're shooting the bedroom scene, and this is our lovely co-star, Miss Sophia Bardot.
Hello, big boy. You like to make kiss with Sophia? Yes, yes.
How much does this job pay?
$100 a day.
Here's 700. Come back in a week.
No. Come back.
$1,000 for a couple of hours here.
So long, big boy. Later on, we may kiss. Yes.
Was she in Little Rascals?
I don't think so. Now, today, our hero is on the chaise lounge with Sophia, okay? Now, when I'm ready for you to take over, I yell stand in. You got it?
Well, when you're ready for me to take over, you yell stand in. Got it?
Okay. We're ready for you, Art.
Art?
Hart.
Hart Hudson?
That's him. Did his hair? We begin with Art making mad love to her. He kisses her forehead, her eyes, her lips, her cheeks, her neck, her shoulders, her...
Then
he'll catch. He continues caressing her. He caresses her arms, her hands, her waist, her hips, her...
Then
she's getting very excited.
I'm doing pretty good myself.
Suddenly she stops.
She forgot to take a pill that day.
There's a knock on the door.
Don't answer it.
The hero springs up.
It's more of a pole vault.
He goes over to the door and he starts to open it and stand it. No, no, you're supposed to go to the door.
I just remembered something I forgot to do down here.
Go to the door.
Be right back, honey. It's probably just the Avon lady.
Print.
I gotta tell you, if that's the foreplay, just what the hell are we leading up to here?
You were great, just great. Where'd you study acting?
On the subways at rush hour. Now, just let me end it all my way. I got a gun here, got a rope.
No, no, no. We got another scene to go. And in this scene... In this scene, our hero is completely healed.
Huh? See, I'm glad to hear that, but I thought he was checking out right there.
Let's roll him. And again, he's in a sweetheart's apartment. And again, they're on the sofa. And he's making mad, passionate love to her.
Stand there.
Suddenly, there's another knock on the door.
Don't answer it, for God's sake, don't answer it.
The hero jumps up, goes over to the door, starts to open it and stand in.
I begged you not to answer it.
Stand in.
Miss Sophia, after I'm gone, would you take care of my parakeet? And tell my mom I never got involved with bad girls. I tried, but I never got involved. No knockers out there. So on to the knockers in here.
Beautiful, just beautiful.
Whoa. I gotta tell you something else here. I think your movie's just a little too kinky for me.
Hey, where you going? You can't walk out now.
If I don't walk out now, I won't be able to walk out at all later. So long, honey. I'm gonna become a homosexual.
This is the scene where you're on the sofa with Sophia.
On the sofa with Sophia?
Yeah. Sofa with Sophia.
I'm the sofa with Sophia.
Nobody knocks on the door?
Nobody knocks on the door.
Nobody comes through the window?
Nobody comes through the window.
I'm the sofa with Sophia! I got the strength left. I got it.
Action! Now the hero is making love to Sophie again. He embraces her, he leans forward to kiss her, and standing.
Say standing?
Standing. That's you.
I go over there?
Right now.
And take his place.
Right now.
Honey, kiss you right on the lips.
They embrace. But suddenly, Sophia jumps up, she reaches under the pillow, she pulls out a pistol and she shoots him five times. She pulls out a pistol and she shoots him five times. Cut! Cut! What's going on here? Sophia, this kind of acting will ruin you in Hollywood.
Who cares about Hollywood? I want to see Philadelphia!
Now, I'd like to give you a lesson in anatomy. Mine. But before that, I'd like to talk about a stripper's work clothes. Briefly, of course. While some started with gloves, gowns, even tiaras, when it got down to bare facts, a stripper's best friends were one, her pasties, and two, her G-string. This is a pasty. Isn't it cute? Looks kind of like a little dunce cap, doesn't it? Only it doesn't go on your head. It gets pasted to the tip of the bosom. And for a girl who is not particularly well endowed, it makes much ado about nothing. As for the G-string, no one knows where the term started. But I'm sure it had nothing to do with the violin. If it had, I think many boys would have paid more attention to their music lessons. But actions speak louder than words. And while I was tempted to modernize this portion, I think it would be more fun to present it exactly as it was. The same music, the same dance, the same costume, and more or less the same body as when I first began. Well, more or less.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, we proudly present Miss Sherry Britton.
Thank you.
production extravaganza featuring Sherry Britton's kittens, Poor Butterfly.
Such an absolutely marvelous audience. I'd like to share some memories with you. But first, I have a very feminine confession. My feet hurt. May I have a chair out here, please, so that I can be comfy and cozy? Thank you very much. Thank you. Doesn't he look young? Probably about 18 or 19. Yuck, I was born 18. Now, I've had a long and varied career, from burlesque to lecturing, and usually on the social impact of the stripper on society. But in between times, I've done leads in 49 plays. And not until my 37th play was I kissed. The man who was supposed to kiss me was an avid suitor, and he wasn't my style, so I never dated him. And I never even rehearsed the kissing until opening night. And then with great vigor, he descended upon me and not only kissed me, bit my lip, which infuriated me. And I came off stage and I did something I really never, never do. I bawled him out in front of the company. Now, the next day, when we got on stage, all kinds of things happened. We had in the company what we call an under-the-breath talker. You people don't hear it, but he absolutely wreaks havoc with the actors on stage. He said something to the lover, who turned his back on the audience, lost his lines, the whole scene went out the window, and we didn't know what happened until we got off stage. It seems the under-the-breath talker said, "Jack the Ripper." And the lover thought he said, "Check your zipper." That'll make anybody lose his lines. Now, in my time in burlesque, in order to become a greater drawing power, you would try to establish greater intimacy with the audience. And you would do so by bringing somebody up on stage and singing to them. Only in those days, you'd be taking your life in your hands. I'm going to do the same thing tonight, but I'm going to be smarter about it. I'm going to find me a nice man with a smiling wife. She's smiling, but I can't tell you how grumpy he looks. And if I can't make him enjoy the experience, what's so funny about that? Are you people together?
Certainly.
You mean he's normally grumpy? Do you think he'd be a good choice?
I think so.
Yeah? No, you can't point to him. Point to him? This is funny. They're all pointing at each other. I'll tell you who I'd like. Would you like to come over there and help me? You look like a very, very juicy victim. Come on, meet me over there. Will we be in the way of the cameras? Come on, come on. Yeah. Now, I'll tell you. Oh, I'm sorry. I was supposed to clear this side. Okay, come on up. Now, I'll tell you, all you have to do is sit down in the chair, relax. You don't move a muscle. You don't do a thing. I'll do it all. When's the last time you heard that?
Not lately.
Not lately? I'll have to talk to you later. Now, how's your stamina?
Very good.
Very good? Okay. How's your resistance?
Poor.
Poor? Good for me. How's your wife?
Lovely.
Lovely? Well, I am very, very happy to get this gorgeous hunk of man up here. And Michael, let's tell him what he deserves, shall we? Don't do a thing, just relax. Doesn't he look relaxed? You deserve 16 lackeys waiting on you night and day, and 32 hands waving fast just to brush your cares away. How you doing so far? Deserve Persian maidens just to stand and peel your grapes. Dressed in pearls, bigger than I am. Girl, in 30 captain sizes and shapes. What'll happen now? See, 'cause what you deserve, you're gonna get. And baby, what you'll get is me. He's rocking me. I'm having the nicest time. If I had an island I could run to, I would run if you'd be there. Would you like to say a few words over the microphone?
Yeah.
Lady like to marry, or just a pretty millionaire. But you'll find out I'm the right one. Time alone will make you see. 'Cause what you deserve, you're gonna get. And baby, what you'll get is me. Now, when I count to three, I'd like you to stand up, if you can. Baby, one. Oh, how you get it. Baby, two. Oh, how you get it. Baby, three. Oh, how you get it. Talk to his wife. She's still smiling, so I'm okay. May I ask what your name is?
Midge.
Midge? And your husband's name?
He's my friend, Carl.
He's your what, Carl? He's your what? He's your friend. Well, how friendly are you? You rehearsing for anything in particular? I'll tell you, Carl and Midge. Midge, you've been an absolutely delightful lady, and I'm grateful to you for lending me your friend, Carl. And you can take Carl home now. He is ready. Thank you. Did you hear what she said? I love it. She said, thank you. Thank you. Now, on a snowy Saturday in February 1942, just before the midnight show in all the New York burlesque theaters, big time burlesque came to an end. Mayor LaGuardia, New York's little flower, decreed that it had become too much of a stinkweed and plucked it up by the roots. The runway lights winked out for the last time. And burlesque went to join minstrel shows, vaudeville, and silent movies in the attic of Americana. Maybe at the end the old girl had grown a bit shoddy, but beneath the garish makeup she wore, you could see what an enticing creature she had been. It was ironic that for burlesque, the only thing left to shed was a tear. Tonight we've tried to roll back the years. If you've felt some of the fun and excitement, then we've succeeded. And burlesque has bumped its way out of the mothballs of memory. As for me, I'll never forget it. I still feel that excitement when the drummer does that beat. The memories of the spots I played are wonderfully sweet. And all of you have made this night a very special treat. Just like those good old days. Gone in memories of the runway. Gone in memories of the runway. Wonderful orchestra, my adorable cast, and mainly for myself, I want to wish you twice the joy that you've given us tonight. Thank you.